So, hi everybody. We start in about 3-4 minutes. Today we'll have a live demo about Git and related issues. And you will also have an opportunity to practice yourself. So, a lot of fun, I hope. Ivan Nazarov will present an interactive exercises with illustration of how the graph looks like when you use Git. So please join.
Well, I hope everything goes well today, because is this either going to work all right, or it's going to spectacularly fail. I don't know. Let's hope that it's going to at least work. So I think it's about time. Should we start on time, or can we, or do we need to have to wait for someone?
Let us wait for 2-3 minutes, Ivan.
Okay. Does anyone see this window with participants, or no one sees it? This one, no. Okay. So, do you see this terminal to the left?
Ivan, me in yes. particular me, I see everything. So both the terminal and the screen.
Do you see the chat? The chat window on my screen.
No, we okay, don't so see the chat on your screen.
You only see notebook and terminal. Okay, great.
Ivan, can you please increase the size of the text font size in terminal? Otherwise, it's very small. Yes, here.
Let me see.
Okay, now it's good.
All right. So it's 3 minutes past half an hour. So
yeah. So in principle, I think that we can start. Yes. Right. Okay. All right, so let's do it.
Let's get good. Okay. I am Ivan Nazarov. I am fourth year PhD student, and I have been developing and programming for maybe 7 years, not professionally, but as part of my daily job, not as part of my hobby developing. So, and however, all this time when I was just programming, I was very, very much afraid of Git, because it seemed to me that although it, I knew that it could record stuff and that it could track stuff, I always was afraid that I could break something important in it, so that I was very much very limited in my understanding of it, and I was just committing to Git and pushing to the remote. That's it. I did not understand what rebase was. I did not understand how what is the true meaning of resetting, for example. And yeah, so my biggest problem with Git was that I was afraid to do stuff in it. And however, about a year ago, I discovered a resource which I am going to use today very extensively, which helped me overcome this fear. Fear of moving things around, of just manipulating Git the way I want it, and the way that it helps with my workflow. And I suspect from personal communications with some of the participants in this in the chat today, and from some colleagues, that this is mostly the general feeling about Git. People are quite reluctant in feeling free in Git and trying to do stuff and just trying to work in it. So today my main goal is not just to cover the basic comments. Of course I will do this, but I will try to make you understand that it is not something horrible when you accidentally break something in Git. That, and I also I hope that you will understand that you can always recover. If you save this work, if you save your work in Git, then you can always recover it. That's the basic idea. And I also hope that you will try by practicing in this tool that I found a year ago, that you can feel much more confident, and this way you will be able to streamline your workflow and never worry about losing stuff or I don't know, debugging stuff. For example, if you introduced some bug in your code, and you can always find it. Okay, so let's start with what is Git. So Wikipedia says it's a version control system which has distributed, which can be distributed across many computers, and has a, and also lists some history notes about how it was developed. But from my understanding, the main key points is useful for you is that Git is a version control system which, when installed in your computer, behaves as if it was installed anywhere else in the world, but by which I mean it has the same functionality if it was running on a server, if it is running on GitHub, or if it's running on your computer. Every folder in your computer, if it's a Git folder, can be a remote repository where you can store your work. And you can also upload it to cloud, and the cloud will be your Git repository, which will respond and interact with when you request and send stuff to it, as you expect. But most importantly, the main feature of Git was not that, it was developed by the creator of Linux. So Linus decided at one time to to create a versioning tool that could help him and his colleagues, his community, in developing the kernel. And he, understanding the limitations of version control software at that time, he put forth the main, feature of Git is that it can allow for fast branching, by which I mean you can always split your work into two and start developing or start working on something else, something adjacent, something like a bug fix, something like an additional feature, while the main work always stays there and other people may continue working on that. So do you see the mouse point, my mouse, or not? Anyone?
Yes, we see. Yeah.
The mouse, the cursor, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
So I will use the cursor to highlight stuff. So if you create a Git repository in your local folder, and do some work in it. After at some point in time, you can have if you want, of course, you can have a look at the internal structure, and you'll see that something which visibly looks like this image. You have a series of commits. Yes, they are green. Each one references its parent, or it may have multiple parents, but it is always a directed acyclic graph. A commit cannot be a part of a cycle. Okay, so these commits and branches, which are simply references to commits, they constitute your local repository. Next, in your local repository, you have an area called stage. This area is used to keep the changes that you wish to move to commit to the history. That is why the word commit is used. So these are your stage changes. For example, you do some stuff, you change a file, you maybe edit a couple of typos in your thesis, and you realize that you should probably save it. So you put it into staging, and then later you do commit, and then it is part of your history. The next important part of Git is actually your working space. This is the directory structure itself. For example, if I open here scikit-learn repository, which I cloned a while ago, you can see that if I put .ls here, yes, this one. Well, it's ls. It contains a lot of files, among which is this one file. Among which is, it doesn't show, okay. Now, ls-la. Well, anyway, it should show the .git file, which is actually the heart of Git repository, okay? But if we disregard this Git, this folder, everything else in this directory is your work directory. This is the place where you keep your files, where you keep your projects related to this particular repository, where you change stuff, and where you actually, this is the place where if you want to have a look at a certain point in your repository history, this is the place where you actually, through which you view that particular point in time. So working directory is a very is often frequently changes. First, due to your own work. Secondly, due to, for example, if you want to investigate some previous point in time in your history. So basically, this is like a vessel in which you pour the snapshots of your repository. So basically these are the main three areas of Git. The fourth area, which is it is not required, but it is useful nowadays, and especially when people work remotely, is the remote repository. It is not pictured on this particular image, but in fact it is, as I said, a similar Git repository to the one that you see in the picture, but on another server, and they communicate. Basically, the workflow starts from your working directory through the stage to the your local Git repository. And then when you think that the changes are ready or worthy of being put sent onto cloud, you commit, let's put it this way, you send them to, you upload them to remote repository. This is the basic, very, very high level workflow. There are many details which I will, of course, cover a bit well during the main part. If we are not discussing in greater detail the technical implementation of Git, it is still worth noting that in that folder which I mentioned, that .git folder, there is meta information regarding current branches, remote repositories, the current state of your not working directory, but the current state of history which Git deployed in your working directory. This state is called head, because it references some commit, like here. It references through master, it references commit, this one, the last one. And it, in fact, it actually tracks, your working directory tracks this head reference. It is possible to move head around regardless of other branches, and we will cover that. And also in this folder, there are Git objects. There are four types of Git objects. A blob, it's a binary large object. This is a snapshot of a certain file or a collection of files which Git manages. There is a tree. A tree is a collection of trees or blobs. Basically, it's a directory. If Git, if you commit something to Git, Git takes the affected files, the affected folders, and then it takes a complete snapshot of them and puts them into a commit, into a tree or a blob in its folder, and keeps them there. The next thing is a commit. A commit object references a tree and references, as a snapshot, yes? And references some parents and some, is actually the method of recording history. And finally, there is a tag. A tag is just a meta message, a meta information attached to a commit. And I will probably, it should be pointed right now that, if we go back to my personal story with Git, I thought that branches were something permanent. In fact, it is quite the other way around. Branches are very mutable. They are like Python list. You can always change stuff on them, and you're never guaranteed that you cannot even sort of this way, let's put it this way, compute a hash of a branch, because a branch can always move around and change and even be deleted. However, a tag in a commit in Git is a permanent reference. This reference is used by GitHub, for example, to allow you to download releases of software that is published there. For example, if you have a look at Scikit, you can see that we can have a look at master here and tags, a lot of tags. Let's look at this one. A tag just marks some commit in history, so you can browse it and you can always rely on it being referring to this particular commit. You cannot move it, unless of course you delete it and create a new one, but that is not usually done, because you actually need to keep releases consistent, and you actually need to release software, and you don't just simply change a tag willy-nilly. Most popular common way of using tags is marking versions of your software. So you don't just simply change your version and then delete a tag and reattach it to somewhere else. It's not very, this is not how things are done in development community. For example, here you can see that in fact this is a tag. It is even marked a tag, and you can see like here in the comment in the address bar that it references this object. Okay, and if I move, for example, to this tag, you see only the tag name changed. So what I was trying to say that Git uses tags to as something to mark a release. So that realization and understanding that branches are always changing helped me feel much less restricted and much more at home with Git. So let's move on to useful comments. Probably most of you have already used these comments in one or another way. This is just a list of git add, a comment that, here's a picture. Git add, which just takes your current files from working directory and stages them into to be committed at some point in time. Then git commit, of course, takes the staged files and commits them to history, doing all the necessary hashing and snapshotting and referencing and updating. And also, some of you used git reset. The most common way of using git reset is to, if for example, you staged some file, but you want to actually to make some additional changes to it, so you git reset that file, and so that it moves, so it's deleted from staging, and is kept only in work directory. And a final comment is git checkout. It basically allows you to update your work directory according to the commit that or branch that you want to have a look at. So these are four basic comments. The next useful commands are, for example, it's git log. Git log shows you the history of commits on your current currently checked out branch. For example, let's have a look at the history of commits on scikit there. Well, it's quite a lot. You see, something that I did, maybe. Well, it's my local branch, and here is the master. Here, you see, it says upstream master and master. So some people did some commits about continuous integration on the 12th of March. Okay, and we can go back to history. As you can see, each message here tells you the exact identifier of that commit, which is a hash, the author of that commit, Oliver Griesel, one of the core developers of scikit, the date that Oliver did this work, and a message that is helpful for maintainers, for debugging, and for tracking history. However, as you can see, each message takes about, I don't know, six lines, which is quite a lot. So a shorthand for git log is git log one line. I will make it smaller, then zoom it in and back again. You can see it just lists the basic identifier of a commit with the message. It omits author information and date information. Only the order is matters. What matters here? So git log. No, Git checkout and Git reset are quite different. You can you check out a file to reset it, but you cannot reset a stage file. Yes, but you cannot, for example, move around in history with reset. You can only for example, you can't check out something. If you want to have a look at a certain branch, you do git checkout, not git reset. Git reset just resets your worker directory, your stage directory to a state that is known to Git. For example, it's either a state in history or it's a certain state prior to some of your actions. Okay. Next useful comments is git diff. I think that most of you know what it does. It takes your current work directory. You see this one, and optionally a commit or some reference, and it just shows you what changes have been made from your work directory to that reference. The other way around, from that reference to your working commit. It is also possible to view changes that you have staged, and you do this by using git diff double dash cached. And it is all possible to compute the difference between two commits, like in this particular example. Among the basic commands is a helpful command is git stash. Basically, if you do some work and you started developing a new experiment or a new method, but you did not complete it, and somebody informed you about a certain bug, for example, in your other in master, for example, which takes priority over your work. For example, you discussed with your colleagues, and they pointed out that something is wrong there. So what do you do? You cannot simply, and you do not want to commit your changes because they are unfinished. They are not working. If you commit them, your repository, as a snapshot of your library, of your code base, will be incomplete and will not be in working state. So what do you do? You use git stash. Git stash is a temporary way, is a temporary storage for your changes in a working directory. It takes your working directory, it compares it to what is currently checked out through head, yes? And then it takes this difference and it puts that in a safe place and gives it some identification information. After you did git stash, you can always use git stash list to have a look at what is currently stashed. You can have many stashes. However, it is very important to know to realize that git stash always is always relative to the head. If you move the head, for example, you do other commits, your git stash may not be applicable, and you will have, when you want to actually take your changes from stash, you will have to resolve a conflict. No big deal. Together we will see how this is done. And reapplying your changes from stash is git stash pop. This is all for the basic commands that will not be covered in the interactive section of the tutorial today. So if you have any questions, you can ask. But I don't think we haven't even gotten to the main to the core of the problem today, to manipulating branches and history. So nowadays you can always have a look at what Git has to offer in terms of its own documentation. Because if you do not document your software, its adoption rates, and it will not be adopted by, it will not be adopted by many users. And so basically your efforts are going will be in vain. So what you do is you can always clear stuff, move to FDS seminar Git. Yes, and there you can type man and the software that you want to use. For example, Git proudly states that it's the stupid content tracker, maybe because its creator wished to call it that way. Anyway, and it basically, let me figure out proper, this one. Basically, it just reiterates what I have said, and it also gives you some helpful links. For example, you see it hints you, it gives you some idea that there is a tutorial in the manuals that you can actually have a look at to get started. It also gives you an idea of a usable minimum set of comments. Of course, in this particular, let's say, part of manual, this list of comments is much bigger than what I have just given to you, but still. For example, you can always take a particular comment, then you can ask help for help, and Git will always give you the complete description. It is not very transparent. For example, this thing here is are the options, but they are not very easily understandable. So, unfortunately, in this particular instance, Git is a software that is learned by doing. You don't just read a lecture on Git or read a book on Git. You read a couple of tutorials, have a basic understanding of what is inside and what, let's say, how the repository is structured and what is your working area, what is staging, and what is a repository. And then when you try to, then you learn a couple of basic commands, and then you try to, when you see something that doesn't work, but you think it should work, you always ask manual and find a particular stuff in there. So basically it's a reference. It's not a student, it's not a study book. And of course, because Git is has a very, is a huge community, and this community grows and works on tons of projects, there are some recommended workflows that you can do with Git. I'm not going to go into detail here, but maybe if you have, if in your spare time, you can have a look at this one. I'll just show you that it exists and it tells you something. Now, let's try to open, I will post the link into chat. So let's try to have some practical practice with Git. So I will open the copy link. Okay, this just a basic description of what you will be working with. This is a tool, a game. This is a game. It replicates Git's behavior to a more or less high fidelity. It does not have Git add because it only its only purpose of this game is to help you feel at ease with branching and with moving history and moving commits. Okay, so in this particular example, we have a tree which starts at commit C0, then moves to C1. We have a master branch pointing at C1. You have a side branch pointing at C3. And why does it have two masters? is it broken? Maybe. No. Okay. It's JavaScript. What do you want from JavaScript? JavaScript is not the best. Okay. So anyway, so this is the tree. Okay, and in many of these levels, you have some goal that you need to reach. Okay, so I'll post the link right now, so you can all open this, and together we will try to do some commits, and maybe have a feeling of what is going on. So, first of all, okay, we will try to commit, to make a branch, to check out a branch, and then something else probably. So here's the goal of the level. If you want to complete this level, you just need to make your tree on the right here look like the tree on the left here. Exactly. Exactly look like it. So for example, if you, let me put this one, okay. So for example, if I want to look at exactly like this, I need to add these strange labels here, and maybe do something with this this arrow. But this is if we want to complete this level. So let's just try to commit stuff. So you basically write git commit, and it adds something. However, let's understand what just happened here. It added C6 to C5, and not C3, not C2, not C1, not C4, to C5. Why is that? Because if I do reset, this command is only in this particular game, because a master had initially a star near it. A star means the branch that is currently checked out. For example, if I have a look at scikit again. I type git branch, and I just hit enter. You see, it lists the currently check the currently available branches, among them is the master branch, like here, and it also has this branch svdd blah 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 with a star near it, meaning that it's currently checked out. So if a branch is currently checked out, that is the branch that you are, that the history of which you are advancing, the history of which you are working with. So if I again here type git checkout, and I type side, you see the star moved from master to side. Now I'm working with side, and I can do git commit there. You can also on your own computers try to do this, and you can see that it changes and reacts. And now you see C6 is now a descendant of C3, not C5 as it was previously. Now, what we can also do? We can also try to check out another branch and do a commit there. Check out, let's try master. We have no other branches right now. Okay, git commit. And you see a C7 commit. Okay, great. Now, maybe you need to, sometimes you are working and you feel that what you're about to do does not quite yet fit into the current branch. You need to create a new branch. This can be done in two ways. First, you can write git branch and the name of a new branch. Let this name be feature. You see, it created a branch feature that points to exactly the same location as master. Why is that? Because master was checked out. And the head reference, which I mentioned here, the head reference was pointing to it. And git branch works by creating a new reference from the current head reference. So basically it just duplicates it. Now, a second option, however, pay attention that feature branch is not checked out. We are still on master. So if I do this one, this git commit again, I am still on master, but feature is already in the past. Okay, let's try something else. We can always create a branch with checkout, but this it's actually important to specify an option here, and we type in the branch name, new branch. You see, it created a new branch from master, because again, head was pointing to master, and new branch was is just a copy of head reference. Now, however, sometimes, as you can see, I was just moving around side branch and master branch. Now we can move around feature branch, new branch. How can I create a branch anywhere else in my repository? Okay, there are two ways here. First, I detach the head. Detach the head means that right now the head of this repository points at a branch which is a reference to a commit. If I detach a head, then do I have a picture? No, I don't have a picture. Okay, if I detach the head, then my head, instead of pointing to a branch, points to directly to a commit. Let me illustrate that with a picture in the game. Git checkout. If you want to detach the head, you just do git checkout, but instead of a branch, you use a commit identifier. For example, let's use C4. You see now the star moved away from master and disappeared and became a head reference. And you see this arrow. You can treat head as a, let's call it this way, an anonymous branch. It does not exist, but you can sort of manipulate it in a way that is like a branch. However, you cannot make this branch real, or it's only it is always anonymous. Its name, there is no name, an unnamed branch. So, for example, we are now at head C4, and we want to create a new branch. Okay, let's git branch, and let's name it FOO. You see, now git branch created a copy of head, called it foo, and but still head and foo, although they point to the same commit, they are foo is not checked out. For example, if I do a commit here, I only move the head, and foo stays in place. And you notice that this game warns us about a detached head state. Git will also warn you about this. So detached head state means that there is no reference to your commit aside from head, and head is always changing. So if, for example, you check out a side branch like I do now, you see now your head is disappeared and nothing references C9. Commit C9 is not referenced by anything. This is called a dangling commit. In Git, there is a way to reference it, but this, way can only be used within some limited time, about a week or two, maybe about a couple of days, because Git internally has a garbage collector that removes such unclaimed, unreferenced trees, commits. Because first of all, they clutter the database, and they have they are quite, they take some large space on the disk. Branch is always pointing to branch is actually, let's call it a tip. And the tip always points to a commit. So you cannot, branch is the tip. If you move branch to someplace else, that place becomes the tip of the branch and branch becomes that place. So I will show you in a minute how it works. Now, the second option of checking, of creating new branch from anywhere is if I use checkout with a B option and I call it bar, the branch bar. And the second option, the second argument here is the commit I want to use as the tip of this branch. For example, I want to use C1. You see, here it is very important. Git checkout B, yes, it not only created the branch at the location I instructed it to, it also checked that branch out. So now if I do a commit, it actually works on bar branch. You see? So right now, yeah, you can ask questions in voice, but please be use this power discreetly.
Okay, so just I wanted to ask this question because I'm kind of lost, and maybe not only I, that about the basic concept, this head, master, pointer, whatever. So now you're showing some advanced techniques and like some advanced behavior, what's going to be if you, if you have this already complex tree, what's going to happen? But I would like to ask again about very simple concepts, like what is the head, what is the master, why they're not coincide with each other, why... what's the typical use case, or at least two or three typical use cases? So right now you're doing some discrete mathematics, trees, structures, and this kind of thing, but the key...
No, Alexei, I disagree. I completely disagree. This is not discrete mathematics. I'm actually trying to use the correct words even here. I mean, the words references, branch tips, and stuff like this. So to your question, I think I covered this, but I think it's worth reiterating that you have a commit history, the green straight line over here. This is not the complete tree. This is just some part of this tree which points to a main branch, to which the main branch points and to which the master branch points. Head is your current reference. Not just reference, it's just head is the tip of the virtual, of the anonymous branch associated with your working directory. If you move your, for example, what repository can we try to work this on? Okay, let's work with scikit. Okay, cd, clear. Okay, now let's git status. It says that we are on branch. Come on. It says that we are on branch svdd and blah, blah, blah. If I do git check, for example, you asked about use cases. Use case, I do a git log and I understand that, for example, this here, I did something wrong here, okay? So this is a commit ID. In that game, the commit ID is C1, C4, C10, C whatever. Simple and easy to understand. Here there are hashes. Okay, so I copy this hash and clear so that it can be visible. Okay, so this is the hash. Now, what I want to do is I want to see what the working directory, what the repository looked like, and I mentioned this at that point in time. I do git checkout and I put the commit. Okay, you see, It was reviewed that I'm in detached head, like that game. It warned me about this state. And it actually points right now. Maybe I have a picture. Hold on a second.
But does it mean that the state in the actual directory changed? So now...
Yes. Yes.
Oh.
Because head is associated with your working directory. If you, for example, I will show this to you. Let me undo what I did yesterday. Git, checkout, SEDD L1, okay? It tells me that my previous head position was something. And now it tells me that, well, everything is back to normal. Git head, checking out head is for exploratory reasons and for maybe branching out. I will show it. For example, I have, we have a readme there, okay? Vim readme. Yes, this is the readme of scikit. Let's delete, for example, this line and save it, okay? Now, git status tells me that I have modified readme. Let's try and check out detached head and see my older commit as I did a couple seconds ago. You see, right now, the working directory, although it points to, that's, maybe I did not understand that myself, but okay. Let me have a more. How? Maybe because the readme was not a very good example. Okay. Okay. Git status. Git checkout. Okay. Git log online. Okay, let's it's hard to pick a particularly good commit, but okay, let's try this one and see if my tree You see what happened here? I changed readme, but readme was not very frequently changed. So when checking out head, there was no conflicts in doing that. So actually, Git allowed me to do this. Now, if I maybe if I try to remove readme, maybe this will be more instructive. Okay, git status deleted. Okay, can I go back and check out? Will it allow me to check out? Should. Git status. No, it actually does not change the working directory. It just changes the reference to the commit. Yes, I was wrong on that, but anyway, it allows you to, for example, but right now readme here is staged, so I can actually do a commit m removing readme. You see, I removed readme, and now git log one line shows me that, yes, okay. It shows me that I was on this branch, yes, which I checked out, and my other commits were somewhere here, see, but now I have a checked out head, and which actually I it does not, okay, I was wrong that I said that it actually changes the working directory. No, it does not. It just changes the reference of the working directory, and to the point, and Git's, let's say, recorded structure of the directory to that point in time. And then it allows you to actually modify it and commit it, and even keep the modifications before the commit, keep stage modifications before detaching head, and then committing it to a new tree or to a new branch. That's what happened here.
Could you repeat the last sentence? The last idea.
The last idea is that Git head, the head reference, does not force change the working directory here. It only changes the Git's recorded state of that directory, but still allows you to work with it as if you wanted to change something. That's what I wanted to say. Okay, so
I'll ask another question.
One second. Maybe I'll maybe the point here was that there must be some real changes so that GitHub should actually require you to stash your work. That's the point. Maybe not deleting, maybe modifying stuff would be necessary. I don't know, I'll have to figure it out. Maybe as a comment to in announcements or in wherever we communicate, I'll give it to you. But maybe it's just an unfortunate example here, because I personally have experienced that it asked me to stash my changes before detaching head and moving them around.
This is when you hit some conflicts, as far as I remember.
There should be some conflicts, but maybe in deleting a line, there are no conflicts. I'll need to investigate that. So your question was, Alexander?
My question is that if you scroll a bit up the console, then it is seen that Git suggests to have Git restore, but my question is, usually we use Git checkout to revert the changes, so it is not a bullet when we have deleted file, so we need to use some additional command.
Git, recently there was I've noticed in Reddit and stuff like this, on Stack Overflow, they were discussing the problems of reset commands and checkout commands from the point of view of understand of whether they are easy to understand. And in recent versions, Git introduced Git restore and Git switch commands. Restore helps you essentially undo your changes as Git it's actually an alias to Git reset, but with some other option set. And Git switch is an alias to Git checkout, also with some other options, but essentially does the same thing. So you can Git reset your deleted file or Git restore. But if I understand correctly, Git restore is still experimental. What's going on? Okay, so Git restore. Okay. Git restore. Restore working files. Basically, it works as it says in. It says restore working files. Okay, and if I ask reset, it not from the outset, but somewhere deep here, it says that you can actually use this comment to restore your working tree. Not hard, but maybe it was soft. Or with a checkout, you can also do this. Restore working tree file. Yeah, you see, not reset, checkout. So basically, restore is a version of checkout, as is the switch. So basically, they split the checkout into two commands so that they are easier to understand. You can use restore, you can use checkout. If you check out a deleted file, it will return it. For example, currently we have deleted readme, git, and we have committed. So git, let's do it this way, git reset. Let's reset the current branch to... Okay. Not that reset. Let's just do it this way. Git checkout svdd l1, and it asks me if I wanted to actually not forget that commit because it's dangling. And now I do git rm readme. Okay, I removed it. If I do git checkout, I can't have auto completion here. So I have to type it myself, me rst. It doesn't, why does it always have to happen? Do we have to use restore? Okay, what's going on? No. I need to use git reset here. Git reset. Can I use it? No, I can't use it. Okay. Yeah, I can use reset head. Yes, and stage changes. Card. And let me see if I have git reset. If I had git readme file, yes, I do. So I had to reset, not check out, a deleted file. And essentially, now I figured out that restore does this thing with a simpler command, basically. Okay, so.
I see. Thank you.
I hope I answered your question. Now, where was I? We were discussing commits and creating branches. And yeah, so we can create branch with checkout B and point a commit to it. Okay. The next time. Oof. We're very much behind. Okay, so you can create new branches. For example, it was not very well demonstrated, but you can, you have some idea, you want to test it, and you know which commit you want to start with. You check out your head there, and you create a branch there. So essentially, what you will be doing is you do this git checkout some commit, checkout some commit. For example, C2. Then you will be creating a branch there. Checkout B. Let's call it fix. You see, and it did. So basically, that's the typical use case. You want to explore, you want to have a look, stuff like this, and essentially this. Another use case, it's not related to git to detach head, but it's most related to the command git bisect, which helps you find the most recent commit when your test or your repository was in a certain binary state. I don't want to go into much detail because it's not typically used. It is useful, but it's not widely used comment in small teams and in small projects. But basically, it allows you you have like a point in time where you're. Let me open the drawing board. You have a point in time when your Git repository worked. You see, like one here. And at some point in time, you don't know where, you have commits here, it doesn't work. So Git bisect uses binary search tree, just binary search. It splits the interval between here, your most recent non-working state, and your most recent working state. And it tries to find the commit where we had a one, but after which we had a zero. Okay, so this is this command actually detaches head and checks it out and does it automatically. You can always automate it. You can even automate it so that it can automatically find the commit that caused a failure. By automating the tests that run on your repository. But that's a digression. So that's another case for Git head. If you want to manually find a problematic, find a bug. Next thing is we can always, if you open, sorry, this one, we can, for example, we have a master, and you realize that you actually shouldn't have moved your master to commit C8. Yes. So what you do is you can git checkout. You want to move your master to some to point to some other commit, for example, C5. How you do that? First of all, you can reset your master. Checkout master, git reset. C5. You see, it now moved your branch tip to a commit C5. Nothing is lost. No work is lost on the whole tree. You still have commit C8, and it still exists and is referenced by new branch. But now master branch, being just simply a pointer, a reference, a tip, points to a C5. And for example, if you now try to work with it, you will be working as if nothing happened in the future. That's the one way of changing master. Another way of changing other branches is the branch that is not currently checked out, which is not currently being used by you. For example, right now we have not checked out side, but we have checked out master. So if I can use git branch and force some branch to point to another commit. Branch F side, and let's point it to, I don't know, let's point branch side to C9. Why not? C9. You see, now C6 and C3 history is not referenced. So it might be garbage collected. It's at an uncertain point in the future. Right now it exists, and in your actual Git repository, it will also stay there. But branch side now points its tip points to C9. So you see, nothing is lost here. If we're not talking about these two. Nothing lost here. Your work is still exists there. So if you reset or you delete your working directory, but not the .git directory, which is responsible for the repository, you can always recover it. In the latter case, by git reset hard, when it just takes the snapshot stored in its memory and overwrites everything in your working directory. What else? Now, if we want to again create some commit some branch that references C6, we can do this as usual, git branch buzz and C6. See, now we reference it. Unless until there are no references, the commit is never going to be garbage collected. So what else? Git reset can also. I showed you that git reset helps you reset the currently checked out branch to some older commit or some other commit in the alternative branches. And the final way of tagging and referencing your commits is tagging. Git tag, first of all, takes a tag name, and then a branch or a reference or a commit. For example, I can tag head because it references C5 right now. Oops, head. You see, tag name appeared out of nowhere. Then I can tag name, I don't know, tag version V, I don't know, 0.1, tag C3 as as version 0.1. And finally, I can tag a branch. Tag version 1.0, I don't care, master. Oh, it's a bit unfortunate. Let's tag, I don't know, feature so that it can be seen. It refuses to add the same tag because tags are unique, so I have to, I don't know, change it. Now tag V11 references feature, and that reference will always be there until you delete it. And you cannot move your tag without deleting it. And deleting a tag is, it's usually, people don't do this, developers don't do it, because tags help everyone keep track of the releases, of the versions of your software. I don't know, if you want, I can demonstrate the same thing, and you can all play around your own consoles with an actual demo in Git, which is just basically I create a demo and I add some stuff there, and maybe at some point in time, we can move around. But that's essentially the same as UI, but without the UI. Here's a picture of how reset works. I explained it to you more or less, I hope, so that you understand this. The syntax of tag is this one. It's git tag name and reference, where reference is anything, be it branch, another tag, a commit, or head. It is also possible to do relative references, but that's a topic for a later time. Now, as a general rule, it is recommended that you make your commits as regularly and as frequently as possible. Of course, it does not mean that you should commit every letter that you write, but if you make some consistent, some well-defined, if you make a change that affects some well-defined aspect of your work, you should commit it. If, for example, you edit a buggy line, a buggy piece of code, and you debug it and you commit it. If you fix a badly written documentation, you commit it. If, for example, you can also use Git to write your thesis, as I mentioned. If, for example, but it requires you to split your lines of text that you write manually into new lines. so that it will be easier for you. Git will gobble anything, but it will be easier for you to track changes. But anyway, it helps you. It can also, for example, you add a paragraph of text or a description for your new experiment or a new LaTeX, I don't know, the LaTeX environment for a figure. You commit it. This way, you can always try, you can always backtrack to individual atomic changes that do not intersect, that are hopefully not overlapping. For example, if you make a debug commit, that debug commit should not include your edits to documentation because they are unrelated. So a commit should not be small, but should be large, but certainly very large to commit unrelated changes, to include unrelated changes. So this is essentially the key strategy of committing. Commit frequently, it allows you to store your work. Commits are actual snapshots of your work, but do not overdo this because Git takes a snapshot. It does not take a difference of what was and what is now. It takes a snapshot and it stores it. So it takes space. So that's the general like trade-off. Now, we have covered, what time is it now? It's 15 minutes. We'll start.
Yeah. You mentioned that we have snapshot, but not the difference. So could you repeat?
GitHub. There are version control software that use so-called delta storage. They take a file, they identify a file, and every change that you make to that file is a difference. So for example, is recorded as a difference. And so each time you want to check out a new head in that software, what is the link for this tutorial text? Which one? This one. It's not posted. But anyway, in those particular software, it has to replay all your changes. Well, of course, it has some caching, whatever, but it essentially has to replay all your changes until the point you want to check out and branch out as a new branch. Okay, so because it's Delta. GitHub does it a little bit in a different way. Git, it identifies each file by its content, not by its name, as older, for example, some other software does. And when a change happens to that file, to that content, Git creates the copy of that, the entire content, and references it and puts it in a tree and references it. So Git repository contains snapshots of all your files in their, not in their entirety. For example, if you change one file, it won't snapshot unrelated files, unaffected files. It will snapshot only that file. But anyway, it always contains the complete snapshot of the whole file.
I see. So you have some overhead on the copy of each file.
Yes. Not a copy, but you have some overhead in terms that it takes some space, but nowadays, I don't know, hard disks are cheap. The overhead comes from the merging difference and computing the differences between files, because Git now has to compare two complete copies of the same content, which it tracks, yes, but which were changed. But they are in their entirety stored in its commit tree. And now it has to, Git offloads the problem of computing the difference and storing it to when you commit to the, and when you branch out to the to a little bit heavier computation when you do merging and comparing different files. So basically, git diff does not show you the difference that it actually stored. No, it shows you the computed difference. It always recomputes the difference. It does it pretty fast, and there are comparisons saying that, well, Git is much faster than other software like Mercurial or SVN or whatever we have. So essentially, Git diff computes difference on the fly for you, and then reapplies it. When you are merging and there is a conflict, the conflict actually stems from the fact that the computer difference the computer difference from the ancestor, for example, and two versions of the same file cannot be automatically matched together, and there are some conflicting changes in one of them. So because it computes, because Git computes these differences. So basically, yes, this actually moves us to the next level in the tutorial. I'll open it right now. It's interesting. We have 10 minutes. I think it will be enough to cover the basic idea. So here, I am closing this one because I don't know if you played it around. There's no way to save it, but it doesn't really matter. It's just a good illustration, and it serves its purpose as an illustration, not as a something else. So anyway, we have this tree here: commit C0, C0, and C1. And the goal is to actually make another branch. Do some work on master again, and then merge these two branches in one. First, we'll try to maybe I can explain, but anyway. So here is the link. Copy link. This one. Here, we will try to use git merge to merge one branch into another. And I will explain how and what is going on here. First of all, we see this target tree. You can follow me. You can actually try to do this yourself. So you can actually type git checkout. Let's create a new branch bug fix. It will be created from the current master. Okay, let's do this. All right, now let's do some work on this bug fix branch, git commit. Imagine that we added some files, did some editing, but this is just under the hood. All in all, we did a commit. Now, for example, it just so happened that we needed to edit something else unrelated to this commit, but on the master. So we move again back to master. We check out the master branch. Master. You see, like the star appeared there, and we do another commit there. Now, you see that the history of bug fix, yes, and master, they have diverged at the point of C1 in two branches. This may seem like a contrived case, but for example, when you pull from a remote repository, from your GitHub repository, you actually what happens there under the hood is exactly the same. For example, you have been working on master here, and let's just for now assume that bug fix is a shadow branch that tracks your remote repository. So when you do git pull from your remote repository, I can draw it from your remote repository. Yes, so you have your current master here, and it tracks remote repository here, master. Okay, for example, some extra work was done on remote repository, so that your remote at the local. Sorry, I'm very sloppy here. So remote now points here, and this is no longer a valid reference. So when you do git pull, for example, in your local repository, there is a shadow branch. Let's call it O/M. R/M. When you pull, first of all, this branch is updated to reflect the latest changes in your repository, remote repository. This is the first step of git pull. We discussed that you actually made some other changes on your master before you do git pull, which let's call them F, commit F, yes? And so what now happens? Git pull, first of all, updated this branch as we did in this example, yes? And then the second step of git pull is actually to reconcile the diverged histories. And it is usually the case that it does so by a so-called merge. It creates a new commit, which references both parents. And moves your master to this new commit. And then then that's it. And then after you've done this, you need to git push, your changes will be transferred back to remote. But this is what happens when you pull and work with the remote. In this example, we emulated this work by with different branch names, but that doesn't matter. We emulated this diverging history, and now we do this git merge command. Let's merge bug fix into master, or it doesn't really matter because they are all parents. The syntax of git merge is is git merge branch name, like this. It does the following. It it computes the common ancestor of your divergent branches, and then tries to resolve the conflicts in them. If there are no conflicts, then your involvement is not required. If there are conflicts, then unfortunately you'll have to resolve them. But in any case, in this example of divergent histories, it creates another commit, the so-called merge commit, because it has many parents, and it actually incorporates the changes made in all of the branches that were involved. So how so basically we have just covered the so-called three-way merge. It takes, for example, if we are currently on master, yes, and we merge the diverging branch other, git computes their common ancestor, this one, and then computes a three-way difference between the tip of the other branch and the common ancestor, and the tip of the master branch and the common ancestor. And then if it can resolve the conflicts automatically, because these conflicts do not affect the same pieces of the same lines of code or the same file, for example, then it can automatically, if no conflicts exist, yes, it automatically creates a merge commit that references all three parents, the common parent and the tips. If there is a conflict, unfortunately, you have to resolve it. After you resolve it, the git moves on and creates a merge commit and stuff like that. Yes, we'll have a break in 2 minutes, so I'll cover. I have a time to cover another thing. Fast forward merge. For example, if you, for example, let's look at this particular tree here. I reset it so that it's visible. Let's again git check out bug fix. Okay, let's call it bug. Don't care. Git commit. And now let's return to master. Pay attention that master is a predecessor of bug. So what would happen if I merge bug into master? Well, of course, the code will be buggy, but that's what will happen to the tree? You see, it pulls it. It explicitly tells me that it's fast forwarding because there was no divergence history. The common ancestor of bug and master was master. So there is no need to force three-way merge. There could be no conflicts because bug is a direct descendant of master. So git can just replay, not replay, just take the tip of master branch and move it to bug branch, to the tip of bug branch. And that is fast forward. There's a third way of merge, which is, as I've read, quite complicated, so I'm not going to cover it, but this method is called octopus merge, which merges more than two branches. It is actually why GitHub has this mascot as an octopus. Well, it's quite complicated, and I have not used it and find a use case in my work that was in my scientific work that was related and that required such a complicated operation. Now, we can have a break if you want, and I will try to figure out what we will do next. Okay?
So let's have a bathroom break for 10 minutes, and we start again at 2:11.
Okay, is everyone back? Now, okay, getting back to the incident with detached head. Here is what was incorrect from my part and what was correct from my part. Okay, if you change stuff in your working directory, you, for example, alter a file, it is not immediately reset to the state of the head you want to detach. Okay. However, if you let's have a look at this at a particular example. Do you see the pic? Do you see everything here? Let me make it a bigger one. Okay. And no, please, more. I don't care. Clear, whatever. So let's undo what I have just did. Yes. Okay, you see, we have a file. Let's call it Scikit-SVM classes. And we have this object here. Support vector data description class, whatever. Here, what will happen to this particular object when I check out, when I detach head to a state which I know, at which I know this object did not exist. You see, here it is. It's line 1, 3 to 5, okay? Now I am detaching the head. Let me show that I'm not lying. Okay, I'll take this one. AA, blah, 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 okay? Clear, git, check out, I detach it. Now, I watch carefully as I refresh the tab on my editor. There is no longer line 3, 1, 3, 20 beyond. There are no longer any line beyond 1,320. That code was removed by my detaching the head. So in this way, it affects detaching head affects the working directory. Now let me go back to the original branch. I can do this either by specifying its name or just putting a dash. Git understands that a dash means the previously checked out head or a or stuff that head was referencing. And in this case, it is a branch SVDD. You see, the object has reappeared. Let me try to maybe delete this line and see what happens. I save and let's detach the head again to that again state. You see, now it says me, you can't do this because your change, the changes that you have made to your current working directory are incompatible with the commit that you are checking out. And so Git refuses to do this. It asks me to commit my changes or stare them. And only after that I can detach head. Because otherwise, if Git allowed me to do this dangerous operation, I would have lost my work. That is why an example with README failed, because README was in a consistent state at a point in time to which that commit to which I wanted to detach my head referred to. So that was the problem. So head, the idea is that head and working directory state tracks head unless there are compatible changes, in which case it might slightly diverge because you added some work and you want to reapply it. If Git can move back by reapplying your the edits that you made, then it's okay, as we have seen with deleting a line in README. But if it cannot, it will swear at you and forbid and slap you on the wrist and not allow you to do any of such stuff. So, yes, the final conclusion is that working directory tracks head, always. All right, so during the break, I received a couple of questions and criticisms, which I hope to resolve now. Let me
Okay, can you now please do this? Okay, yes, super. Now I will move to another screen. New share, advanced portion screen, share, move this way. Can I please do loud, what? Yes. Do you see the screen right now? Because I don't see the chat. Where's the chat? The chat participants and the chat. Please from the chat. Yes, thank you. Yes, tag name reference. No, it's all right. So first of all, first thing was that I wanted to clarify is I was pointed out a question: why should I use Git when it involves so much complicated stuff, when I can just dump all my work into Dropbox and that's it? First response, rebuttal to this legitimate question is that Git is, we're not discussing distributing software here. We are discussing tracking changes in your software so that you can always rewind your changes, and have a look at them, inspect them, dissect them, and maybe fix them. First point. Second point, Git allows you to split your workflow between many contributors so that they can work on branches in parallel. Of course, modern collaborative software like Dropbox, like Overleaf, does it for you, but I bet that under the hood, they use a certain version of version controls, certain version control software. Git is the version control software. It's not some, I don't know, cheap tool. It's a really sophisticated, it's a hard tool, yes, but it's a very sophisticated and functional tool. So if we are trying to track our history in Dropbox, Dropbox does it okay for you, but it does it allow you to make a branch so that you can actually show to your colleague an alternative version of your software? Does it allow you to split your workflow and work in private on a grand new improvement of your software while others are still using a stable and reliable but an older version of your software? No, it doesn't. Git allows you to, all these things. And I suspect a third point in Dropbox or a similar solution like Google Drive or whatever, you cannot actually collaborate on the same file. It will ask you to choose a file, and it won't allow you to merge them and manipulate the history as such, as Git does. So doing in Dropbox is okay, but it's a poor man's choice when you are actually don't have any money to get a hold of a free software like Git. So a very strange choice, mostly stemming from the fact that Git seems complicated, and it is, but it's not that complicated as to warrant any silly solutions like storing versions on Dropbox. I used legitimately to take my file, my thesis or my code, pack it, put a timestamp on it, and copy into it into a separate directory called archive. Does it solve a problem if I have a bug in some code somewhere? No, it doesn't. I'll have to manually list through all these files to put them in some sandbox and then work with them. Very cumbersome. Git streamlines this. What else? Since we have GitHub, and let's have a look at Wikipedia, shall we? Wikipedia and Git. there were some adoption rates here. Yes. You see, these are the adoption rates of Git software since 2015. Around the time when, well, 8 years late after it was developed, but around the time GitHub became popular. Git now is the ecosystem. If you are using other stuff, albeit it may be good, or it may be functional, but there are some benchmarks that say GitHub is pretty fast. You will be actually vying for a niche, which should only be warranted by your particular applications in production. For example, you maintain a server with a Mercurial or SVN repository, and it works. Don't touch it. Okay, so that's one option. I used to work in a bank where we were developing a warehousing solution for their huge database of all transactions, of all accounting transactions, which are extremely detailed. And each object in that warehouse, SQL object, a table, they were pretty in high detail, but described through Excel files of their properties, of their responsibilities, of the person who developed them, stuff like this. And specifications as well. And all these specifications were managed in SVN, a really old Subversion system. For example, SourceForge still runs on SVN. It's a good solution. It solves the same problem as Git. So if you have same problem of tracking versions, but there are slight differences. I'm not ready to name them at the moment. Apart from the fact that SVN does not allow you to rename files or move files around, while Git does it and does it good, and Git is faster. But still, if you choose always a tool, the tool that you choose should always satisfy the needs of your solution. There are no good tool or bad tool. All tools are all right. The question is whether it allows you to solve your problem. Dropbox allows you to solve your problem, but what if another problem comes up and you want to debug your software and you want to distribute it and you want to collaborate on it? Does Dropbox solve your problem now? No, it doesn't. Version control software does it. So that is my response to that question. I'm not sure if it's convincing, but maybe it was a little bit passionate, but still. Okay, so where were we? Yes, we were discussing merges of histories, fast forwards, and three-way merges. Now, where is it? Okay, here we are. Three-way merges. So branches diverge, and Git computes their common ancestor and tries to align the file, the objects, the files, yes. And if everything is all right, it can automatically resolve the conflict. For example, if Alice edited the first couple of lines of the code and Bob edited some lines in the middle, and they are not overlapping, yes? Of course. These lines might actually make your software to fail, but in terms of the content of the file, they are non-overlapping. Here's what I mean. For example, there is a, we will cover this in FDS course on later lectures. Rodrigo will cover it, as far as I remember. The question of unit tests and integration tests. For example, Alice affected some property of your method. Bob affected some algorithm that uses the things that Alice affected. And altogether, they may pass the test and Git won't notice any conflicts because on the content level, there are no conflicts. But when you integrate these two pieces together, you'll see a spectacular failure. For example, your raw cauc may be below 0.5. Very spectacular failure, I guess. Okay, so that's slightly divergent, but anyway, content-wise, Git tries to resolve them. If it can't resolve them, it will ask you to give Git a lending helping hand. Now, merge operation does not change history at all. It only creates a commit that references the parents and the tips of the branches. However, I've told you earlier that sometimes it is better to keep certain things together and separate it from, let's say, other changes. If we merge two branches, for example, one branch, a person was developing UI. On another branch, a developer was concerned with the backend. For example, how how parsers work. And there were two branches, and then we merged them. This way, we are bundling seemingly separate pieces of development. However, there's no other way to actually merge and unify the history of your project. However, if a person that was developing UI and developing another person developing the backend were constantly trying to merge their stuff between each other, then the history would be very intricately connected web, which is hard to follow. Because, for example, if a bug is introduced, then you will have to decide which parent you want to inspect, which parent's parent you want to inspect, and stuff like this. Really, it's not very usable. So sometimes when merges are made, it is desirable to so-called squash the commits into a single huge commit, which basically combines all the work done on that on the branch upon divergence, of course. This is called squashing commits. It is useful, for example, in Scikit, when you want to make a pull request to Scikit, they ask you to fork the repository, work on the repository. But when they approve your pull request, they actually merge and squash all your work into one single commit. So that so why is that? Then your feature, the whole implementation of your feature, is encapsulated in a single commit. It is not spread among many commits in the master branch of Scikit. It is concentrated in a single commit. It does not spill over to anywhere else. There might be bug fixes. It's allowed, but still it is concentrated. Now, what if for example, you're not pulling requests, making pull requests to Scikit. You were developing your own, your own branch. So let's, which one is it? Okay, it's this one. No, it's not this one. Let me find the correct. Let's have a look at this particular example. I shall post the link right now. Yep, there you go. For example, you were working on a branch, on a master branch, yes? And you figured out that there is a bug on the in the current version of software. What do you want to do? You need to actually do some debugging stuff. You use Python debugger, you use more low-level debuggers, debugger. You introduce a couple of printfs sprinkled here and there so that you can actually trace the workflow. But unfortunately, you had to go home and start and continue working from home, so you had to commit them to your branch in the remote repository. Here we're looking only at the local copy, which you have by coming home. You have pulled it from remote, and you see this local copy. You have debug, printf, and bug fix. Many branches, but the debug and printf are for just for illustration here. So you're at home, you developed a fix for the bug. But now what you need to do is you need to actually incorporate your changes from bug fix into master. The problem is that you should not incorporate debug information. How do you do this? This is where rewriting history comes into place. You rewrite history with rebase. There is a lot of debate about whether people should use rebase or not, but it mostly boils down to the following rule. It's a preference, of course, yes. I like rebase, it linearizes history, but the idea is that if you work on a shared branch, if your branch is shared by your colleagues and they also work on it, then never, ever do rebase, because otherwise careless application of pools, git pools by your colleagues may introduce, may just entangle all the history with merge commits, and it will be a huge mess. So if you work on your own branch, rebase whatever you want, however you want, whenever you want. So here, our goal is to, first of all, rebase, to incorporate changes of bug fix onto master. Master branch is the one that is the store. It's not a repository or whatever. Master branch is a reference to a commit, but it symbolizes the main the reference version of your software. For example, like a master copy in DVD or in movies, there is a master copy which then is copied onto other digital media or other media or digital media and then distributed. But there's a master copy which is the reference, the ideal object in terms of that the ideal of that particular movie. For example, here master, usually it's a master branch. It refers to the correct ideal version of your software. And every other branch is just your local modifications, fixes or attempts or experimentation. So right now we have found the fix and we want to incorporate that fix into our ideal version. So what we do here is we do git rebase. Rebase takes one argument compulsory, secondary optional argument, and a flag. Now, what let's try, so basically rebase, what will it do? I am describing you what will it do, and then I'll show you how it does it. Rebase will take the common ancestor of the current branch, which is bug fix with a star here, and the base branch, which I now am going to specify. It takes these two tips of the branches and computes their common ancestor. Right now, it is master. So if it were a merge, then there would be no problem. Merge would just fast forward. But if I am doing rebase, Git is smart enough to recognize my intent. For example, if I do rebase like this onto master, it won't do anything. You see? Because it said that bug fix is already a descendant of master and everything is all right. Now, what I can try an option with the so-called interactive rebase. Git rebase I and the same base branch master. This way I want to tell Git to have some let's say control over what Git will be rebasing. Now look at what is going to happen as I press enter. It offers me a list. Well, in this particular software, it is a very simplified game. Yes, it offers me two options. I can reorder commits. You see, like this one. I can omit them. For example, let's reorder them like this, and leave out the third commit. Let's see what happens as I press confirm. First of all, Git chose the commits in the order I specified, and then, and here's the important, it replayed those commits, reapplied. They are not copies of the original commits, no. They are reapplication of the changes made between snapshots of those commits. That is why sometimes when you rebase, it is possible to experience a conflict, rebase conflict. It is exactly the same as merge conflict, but just stemming from a different operation. So you see, I have, using interactive rebase, I have picked out some commits that I thought were necessary and replayed them atop the master branch. And Git graciously updates the reference of my branch bug fix to the new tree. You see, the histories have diverged now. Now, let me reset and reapply the same command. Now, let's try to try to solve the task here. So we see that C2 debug should be left out and printf should be left out. Okay, and C4 was actually the main value of our work. So let us just omit these two. I can reorder them. It doesn't really matter. I can omit them. I can pick them. So I'm just omitting them. And I press confirm. So right now, the same picture, but with a different list of commits. Right now, Git replayed commit C4 on a top master. And what I can do now is I can say, all right, I'm okay with this. So I actually update my local master git branch f master. Oh, did I cover, have I discussed my this one? I haven't. Okay, let's discuss now. Git branch f takes two arguments, the name of the branch you want to operate on, and the second is the reference to which you want to update that branch's tip. Right now, I want to update it to reference to a commit reference by bug fix. So this command forces master's reference tip to point to what bugfix refers to. You see? So basically this so we have moved master from C1 to C4. Now if we had in this particular, we don't, but if we had a repository on GitHub, you would do git push. However, git push in this particular case, git push will work fine. But unfortunately, in the case when there happened, if some extra work by your collaborators happened on master, git push will forbid you to do this operation, and instead will require you to resolve the commits first, then rebase them, and then move try push once again. So in this particular instance, everything will be fine, and if you push master, the remote branch will be just updated with a C4 apostrophe commit. Okay, so well, let's just check out master and finish this problem. Yeah. So next thing. So yes. Mm-hmm. So here are the let's say the essential ideas of what rebase should be used for and master and the merge should be used for. Again, you merge parallel long-term developments to reflect symbolic reunification of the work. Be good. Sorry. It makes a mess. Let's see how what it does. Okay, you have we have seen this actually. Yeah. So rebase, on the other hand, allows you to linearize your history, to squash commits, and to make them more compact and relevant. Unfortunately, you can squash commits, but you cannot let's call it split them. So that's why you should commit as often as you can, reasonably. Now let's have a look at Git demo 3, which will take place both in the game and in console. Let's try this experiment. I'm closing this one and I delete this and I copy this link address here. See, this is an example which I prepared for you, which would illustrate the tree that exists in this example. But I actually added a couple of extra, let's say, code so that the files make sense. Now, I was also during the intermission asked to show if it would be possible to demonstrate how one creates a GitHub a Git repository. Well, there are. Let's start from this and then slowly move to this example. Yes. So let's open GitHub. GitHub.com. Okay. New repository. Let's call it Git demo 5. Whatever. A demo for Gitting. And let's initialize this report. Let me think. Okay, let's add, I don't know, CC by, let's call the MIT license and for Python, whatever, Python, yeah, can we use this, or can we use the Python macOS? Okay, Python. Oh, you can, oh, I can. Latex. Oh, okay, I can't choose anything else, but anyway, let's create this repository. Git created this repository and populated with a couple of files. So one way of creating a repository is I take GitHub and I instruct it to create a repository for me. And I actually, GitHub initializes it, so I just copy the link. And let's move on here. this here, and it's cd fds. So git. What do we have here? We have okay, let's call it cd practical and this mkdir remote GitHub. CD remote GitHub. Clear. So first option is we git clone. And we specify the address of the repository. You see, I specify the URL. Optionally, this command also accepts a target directory, but if the target directory is, it should be a non-existent directory, of course, because it will refuse to clone into an existing directory because it doesn't know what it can spoil there. It's very careful, it's very conservative. So by default, it will create, it creates a git demo folder where the repository will be located. Let's cd into this and ls the files there. You see, readme and license. As you can see, dot git ignore isn't shown because the macOS and Unix systems inside the systems dot files are hidden. But anyway, this is a legitimate way of creating a repository. It populates it with a readme, a really simple stub, and a license. Now, what if I want to create a repository not for using GitHub, but using only my local machine? Okay, how do I do this? I find a place where I want to keep it, and I type git init. And the folder where I want the Git repository to exist. Git demo 5 local. Just a stupid name. You see, initialized empty Git repository in users, blah, blah, blah. Okay, let's have a look. Git demo 5. Local. Less, what do we have here? Nothing. Can we check out Git? Yeah, we can. And inside it, we have some references, internal machinery of Git. It is none of our concern right now. So let's go back. So right now, this repository is empty. Okay. How do I actually and let's do some work here. Let's create some stupid files there. License and echo. Let's call it exclusive. Okay. Now what have I done here is a vim license, and it has the word exclusive infinite. Okay. All right, trying to use the knowledge gained in intellectual property course here. Okay, so I have created this file. How I edit, git add, license, okay, add. Now, let's have a look at the commands that I started my today's seminar with, git diff. If I put git diff, it will output nothing because there is nothing to compare against in the working directory because git add staged the file. You see? Okay, let's actually ask it to compare staged and current checked out branch. Cache. You see? Well, it says here new file, index 000 is the root commit. You cannot go beyond that. And it says that it created a file from devnull and added license with a one string here. Okay, so seems legit. Git commit, and let's license. Okay, so now we have our first commit. Okay, you can all try at your own desks or laptops to follow me, because you just need to create a new repository at GitHub, and at the moment it is free even to create private repositories and even add small teams. So I don't think it's a huge problem. Now, I have created this alternative repository, and now I want to actually upload it to GitHub. How do I do this? Well, I can actually create a new repository. I'll have to, because GitHub should know about the existence of a repository. Let's call it this one, GitHub local. See? Description, whatever, public, but this time I don't want to initialize this repository as anything. This is called a bare repository. It is completely empty. Now, you see, if I create an empty repository on GitHub, I get several options. First of all, I can clone it and start working on it. By cloning, I mean it will just create an empty repository. I can import code from another repository, which Git provides UI for. Here is, you see, basically I just init it, and then I manipulate stuff. Let's try to use this approach. What do these instructions mean? First instruction means instructs Git, my local Git would instruct it. Let's start with this, okay? Oops. This instruction would instruct Git to do something with remote, okay? I shall explain in a second what is remote. Now, remote, let's open this one. So essentially, Git has four areas. This is a working directory. This is your current files that you see, yes? This is staging area. Here you have your repository. Now, this is how it looks like right now if I do not run this command, okay? This is all that Git knows right now in this repository. Now, how do I actually make it understand that there should be some other cloud storage for my work? Into the picture comes the so-called remote repository. Here, I draw it here, it's a remote. And this is local. So right now, remote repository is this thing, although it's named not very, very, let's say, well, but it is still exists on GitHub servers in the cloud, belongs to Microsoft. So how do I instruct Git to actually know that there is such a thing as remote? I do this with using a command git remote. If I press enter, it will do nothing, because by default, git remote lists all currently registered remote servers. Git remote, let's ask it to be verbose. Still nothing. Okay. Man, git remote, help me. Manage set of tracked repositories. Okay, so git should be instructed to track this repository. Now, let's have a look at this part of the command. on the command. Help. Git remote add. Fetch the what it does. It doesn't tell me what it does, but it gives me the idea of the arguments. Okay, let's have a look at git remote. Maybe it has some clearer message. Git add. Okay, add the remote named remote repository named after name for the repository in at the URL for the server at URL. So basically, I take this URL of the server, attach some name to it, and I'm done. Okay, let's do this. GitHub provides me with a standard named remote, and cautiously does gives me the URL. Okay, let's press enter. It did not swear at me. So let's have a look at the list of remotes. You see, now it has, it used to be nothing here, but now it has origin for fetch and origin for push. Let's try to associate the work that we have done, which is git log, adding a license file, and try to add this work into the remote repository here. Instead of this picture, we'll see the file. How do we do this? There is as with every let's say client-server communication, there are methods of communicating from the client to the server and from the server to the client. In this particular instance, the client is my local repository, and the server is the remote. Let's call it the remote. So what I need to is somehow push the data from the local to the remote. Okay, let's try to push it. Push. Oh, it says that something is wrong. It says that the current branch has no upstream branch. What does it mean? In Git, So right now we have associated remote with the local. But that's not the whole picture. We also need to add a set of so-called remote tracking branches. These are track. These branches will just be shadow copies of the state of the remote branches. For example, a remote might have a branch called foo, which I want to track, which I want to exist, which I want to be able to update, to have a look at. So what I'm, what tracking branch does, if I add a tracking branch, let's call it O, for a shortcut for origin, /foo. This branch will track the changes. Well, through this branch, the changes and updates of the remote will be poured to my local repository. Okay, so how does it translate to our situation here? So it says that current branch has no upstream branch. Upstream branch is a synonym for tracking branch, just a different language. So and it tells me to set git push set upstream origin master. Okay, let's do this. Let's set upstream origin master. This is just a suggestion by git for a particular action. Now, what's going to happen in the repository? You see, in fact, GitHub instructs us to do something similar, but instead of upstream, it uses a shorthand. Okay, let's hit enter. Now you might be familiar with this output. It says that it has done some counting, it prepared the packages for uploading and uploaded them to git demo local. And now it tells me explicitly that branch master is set up to track remote branch master from origin. Let's have a look at where is this thing in here. Git branch the, let's be very verbose, okay? No, not enough. You see, you have a master branch. In the brackets, it says that it tracks origin master. And we have a remote branch, which I conveniently marked red here. Of course, the name is foo, but the name is master. And it tracks this stuff that happens to my remote repository. Now let's update this. Now we have a copy of the, we have created a local repository, then created a placeholder, a so-called bare repository on GitHub for that, for them to communicate. And we have associated the remote repository, GitHub, through the window we have here called tracking branch, and associate with the local repository. Now I can do whatever I want. I can even check out the tracking repository. It actually tells me that it is in the detached head state, because origin master repository, this branch, it is a read-only branch. In terms of, by which I mean that it can only be updated from the remote. And only when, let's say, uploading to the remote, it can only be updated when I'm dealing and talking and instructing Git to operate with remote. I cannot commit to origin master. I cannot, force this branch to any other commit. I can only interact with it and update it through Git pull, Git push. However, so when I check it out, Git just conveniently substitutes and does a detached head. You see here. Now, let's and in detached state, I can actually update license echo terms. Whatever, git add, close the add here, and git commit my terms. You see, it allowed me to make a commit, but I'm not committing to origin master. I am doing my work with the detached head state. And so if I create a branch, git branch, branch. Well, let's call it feature. Let's be more proper here. Terms. You see, it allowed me to do this. Now let's have a look at what we have in terms of the branches that are available in my local repository. You see, I have head detached because it's a virtual anonymous branch. I have master, which tracks, and I have terms, which is only a local branch, and the remote here is as it was in my previous call to Git branch. Now, what if I want to set terms branch to track origin master, for example? I can also track other branches. What I do is I do push git. First of all, let's check out terms because we are currently in detached head state. Yes, git push, and I instruct it again, minus u origin, and now I can I just type the name of the branch. This creates an association of the branch, that would create an association of the branch with the master branch. However, this would create an association with a new branch on the remote. Let me show you how it does. So basically, this creates the branch terms. Our previous call to git push created an association with branch master and created that branch over there. You see, let me try. back here, it said new branch, master. Remote created a new branch in itself. Now, here, this is going to work just the same. It says new branch terms. Let's have a look at GitHub. You see, it already instructs me that something changed. Compare pull request, whatever. Able to merge, yeah, you see, commit, and here is the result. Sort of works, but I don't need to do this right now. So here we go. How do I create a third branch that can track any other branch? Here's how I do this. Let me create a branch, I don't know, experiment. Minus B experiment and check out it immediately. You see, I want a new branch. Git branch experiment. Okay. Now let us instruct experiment to track not a new branch on the remote, but a master branch. This one. How do I do this? I use command git branch. U origin / master, and it tells me branch experiment set up to track remote branch master from origin. Okay, how does it look? VVA. You see, now experiment tracks master, but is ahead by one commit. Master is again master, and terms is terms. What would happen if I do git push? I'm currently on experiment, so git push should actually upload the changes in the experiment branch to through the remote tracking branch, like this, to experiment. Let's enter. Your awesome branches does not match the name of the current branch. To push the current branch, well, it actually tells me that unfortunately I need to have match name, because it is not very standard application. You sort of usually one branch tracks a similarly named branch on the remote. So okay, let's just force. Let's just do what Git tells us to do. Let's push, git head master. Okay, it did something. And you see, it tells me that something has got updated. Let's have a look at the branches. Now, experiment is on par with master, but our original branch master is behind. Okay, let's have a look at here. We are currently at master, so two commits. Great. GitHub doesn't know about this whole mess of a structure that I have locally. It just tracks this branch and this branch, master and terms. Now let's head back to master branch here. Git checkout master. Your branch is behind one commit and can be fast forwarded. So we are currently in the situation. What happened here? Experiment is bug, is the same as bug fix here. Okay, so git checkout. We experiment, I don't care, git commit. We are currently, experiment is here. Now, and the master is here. If I do git pull, for example, here, I do git pull. I cannot do it in this game because there are no remote repositories just now. So if I do git pull, I'm currently on master. So it should update the master according to the remote the tracking repository information that it has or it will download from the remote. So if I do this, it is going to try to merge two histories, but the histories are extremely simple. One is descendant of the other, so it is going to fast forward. Let's hit enter. Oh, you can see it fast forward. Okay, so now if I look here, I see that everything is in order and up to date. Now, this is the essential creation of remote repositories and local repositories. If you're like me, you sometimes start with your. How do I track branch? Okay, let me have a pause and see what's going on in the chat. How do I track branches without UI? Well, how do I track? You mean changes. How do I visualize them? Only by inspecting the currently available branches through the git branch command, like this. So these are the tips of the branches, and these are the tips of the remote tracking branches. If I want to move around, I start usually with some branch and start and see its log, the history of its commits, and start working from there. However, there is modern software for visualizing git branches. There is a Sublime Merge, I guess, expensive software, $60, but it can also be for free. It allows you to actually interface, have a huge UI interface with Git and see all this stuff. However, it is there is a standard visualization tool, very basic, supplied by Git, called GitK. It is simple. And it's as simple as a hammer. If you're on macOS or in Unix, you need to install it because it is not supplied by default, but it is Git. It's created by Git, so GitK. You don't see anything. Okay, let me share the screen once again. You share basic to this one, share. Okay, so you see it's an extremely simple tool. It shows in very not very let's say clear manner, not very let's say easily visible manner, but it shows you the history. Let's inspect the history of something as complicated as scikit. Okay, let me do this. I close, and is it scikit here? Yes, it's scikit here. Git k. You see, now it is very populated. Look, a lot of history happens here. I can scroll it. I can see all authors. For example, Oliver Griesel here. Maybe we can find Gael here. I guess he's not very actively developing scikit now. You can see merge. You see, the history is very linear. Because scikit maintainers maintain it to be linear. They squash commits and they merge them. So this is a merge commit. You see, add multi-class, and you see, like, look here. Fix, blah, blah, blah. Do we have information about comments? Oh, you see, comments here. Yes. Uh-huh. And we can see the changes here. It's a very basic tool. It is available, you just install it. Now let's, we can go back in time how I want. Let's look at a not so well maintained repository, which, by my authorship, okay. Let's have a look at this repository. You see, the history here is not linear. At some point in time, I kept one version, then I started developing another update to the version and overhaul, which I finally merged with into the master, because I decided to make a release, for example. And we can see back in time that it also has these, let's say, non-linearities and the web of dependencies. Actually, we can have a look at GitHub itself provides you a visualization tool. However, you need to update your remote for that tool to work. So github.com/this one. And insights network. You see, it's very simple tool. Basically, it does. Let's have a look at this particular situation here. Okay, it essentially is a transposed view of GitK visualization tool. You can see here and docimprov. Yes, docimprov is here. You see, like, it doesn't show tags. Git doesn't show tags here because these are tags. You see that. Like a tag, small yellow tag. But it shows essentially what has been merged into where and how it's been merged and when. So it works. So, okay, I'm closing this. I'm getting back to share portion of screen, please. And let's move it this way. A little bit lower. Okay, now I need to see the chat. Chat. This is in fact with UI git log has lots of visualization options. Graph show. Okay, let's try git log. I guess let's try in a simple one. Yes, let's try one line. Not very informative. Let's try it on something complicated. CD. Oh, no. Okay, thank you. CPL. Where am I? Let's try this one. Oleg, you are right. It shows you the structure with it is actually GitK, but with the console UI. You see, I minimized it as much as I can. This stuff is just the same as Git, as GitHub show you, but transposed, and as GitK show you. But I frankly thought that. If I wanted to visualize stuff, SCI graphics are not very intuitive. But this works. This works, although you have a very small window of inspection here. You can only inspect like 80 lines in the standard terminal. Well, you can move the window, but still. I think UI tools, and GitK is a basic tool. It's not like some, it can be installed, like it takes about 10 megabytes of stuff. So it's usable. Basic usable tool. Now, unfortunately, I can't show you more advanced tools like Git Merge. I don't want to advertise them because I think their price is ridiculous. But anyway, what else do we have? The questions. Everything displayed in GitHub can also be in the terminal as a one. It's not a question. Have pushed experiment branch into master, right? Yes, we. Locally, our branch was named experiment, and a branch is just a reference. It is not something physical like a commit. It is a reference. So yes, I named my branch locally experiment, but then when I tried to push it, and then when I tried to push it, although I have associated a remote with it, Git actually sworn at me by saying that, come on, you're trying. There's something fishy here. Are you sure that experiment and the master are the same? That is why I had to do that weird comment here. Git push origin head. This syntax actually instructs Git to push to a remote called origin using the source branch head and affecting into the remote branch master. So for example, I can, using this command, I can create remote branches. I can delete remote branches. So let me go back to FDS here. Git, what else? So practical, and we have remote GitHub. Remote GitHub. What's, where am I? Okay, it's cd git demo local. Git branch VA. And let's zoom in. Okay, so I can create remote branches locally by doing this. For example, it is a very simple repository. Maybe it would be more instructive to show it on something more complicated. No, it's just the same. Okay, so git push. And let's delete remote master. Very dangerous situation. Don't try this at home. But let's delete it. It does not allow me to do this because it's the current branch. Okay. The thing is that maybe master is a bad example because master is the default repository and it's not. I haven't checked out how to affect to change the default repositories because, for example, there is some debate about whether the master branch should be named master because it has some bad connotations in the Western world. Okay, so let's try to delete terms because it's not checked out and I'm lazy to check out terms. Okay, push origin terms. Have a look here. You see, two branches. Enter. Deleted terms. All right. Are you sure that we have deleted terms? Yes, it has deleted terms. Now, you ask, what about the local branch? No, local branch exists because I was just affecting the remote repository. This one, VA. You see, it still exists, but look, the remote tracking term, the branch terms, is also still present in my repository. As a reference to it, at least some meta information, because you see now it's gone as a branch. But the attachment of the branch terms to a remote tracking branch still exists. So I need still to update it or remove it completely. Now let me push the branch terms to something else. Let's for example, push experiment to terms. Unfortunately, they have the same content, but that's just to illustrate that I can push whatever I want, wherever I want. It says new branch created, and it informs me that I need to create a pull request. Let's have a look. We have terms again. All right, what do you have in terms of the branch? This operation did not update the remote tracking link from experiment to origin master, but it actually recreated.
Ivan, we have 5 minutes left. I will say, why not we do a summary of what we have learned?
Because I deleted it, removed it a while ago. So. That is how you can actually manipulate branches however you want, wherever you want. But remember that unless you committed your work, it is let me word it that once you have committed your work, then once you have committed your work, you can do whatever you want. You can create new branches, you can push them to remote, you can associate remote with them, you can do whatever. But once you have deleted a commit, then your work is gone, of course. However, deleting a commit is not possible because Git does not allow you to do this kind of stuff with the basic command. Of course, you can always surgically remove stuff. When is commit deleted? I'm actually summarizing the whole the 3 hours here. Commits get removed when there is nothing referencing them. Like in Python, your objects, Python has a garbage collector, yes? Your objects exist while something references them. When that something is itself garbage collected or removed, the action of dereferencing takes place and the object gets dereferenced. If the number of references that the object has decreases to zero through dereferencing, then after a while, an uncertain amount of time, Python's garbage collector will collect and free the memory of that object. This object will never be anymore. The same is with GitHub, with Git. Your commits exist as long as something are guaranteed to exist as long as something references them.